chair of the House Democratic Policy Committee, and I'm from Mercer County. Policy Committee Chair Mike Sterla has asked me to run this meeting while he participates remotely. For everyone's information, this hearing is being recorded and utilizing Microsoft Teams software for remote testifiers and members. Those joining us remotely must turn off their cameras and mute their microphones until called to speak. The public is watching this hearing live online. At this time, I would like the members that are present here in the room to introduce themselves, and we can start to my far left.
Tom Calagirone, 127th District, City of Reading.
Mary Isaacson, Philadelphia County, 175th District.
Representative Chris Sinod, I represent the 9th District in Lawrence County.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Bill Kortz. I'm from Allegheny County, 38th Legislative District.
We are also joined remotely by Representatives Harkins, Daly, Malagheri, Miller, Donatucci, Sanchez, Rabb, Zabel, Warren, McClinton, Schusterman, Webster, Hanbidge, and Hohenstein. Our hearing today is on essential workers, and before we get started in hearing from our panel, I believe that Representative Harkins has joined us remotely. He's the Democratic chair of the House Labor and Industry Committee, and he would like to make some opening remarks. So, Representative Harkins, Chairman Harkins, if you're available, if you could unmute your microphone, and we'd like to hear your opening remarks.
Thanks, Chairman Longetti. Great to be with you. I wish I was down there with you, but I had a number of things come up in the district this week, so I won't be heading down. But what a great issue we're discussing this afternoon on essential workers. We're watching intently this afternoon to see what's being rolled out on the federal level, to see how the federal government plans on helping out these critical workers. And to provide the much-needed assistance to these employees who help us and have helped us through these tough times of the last few months and the different things that we've come across that we never anticipated, no one could ever have anticipated. We're working with the Federal Department of Labor. I was on a conference call with someone from there at 12:30 this afternoon on some of what they believe is going to transpire and how that could impact the states, primarily the unemployment claims, PUA, and some of the other related issues. Worker safety is also another concern of mine that I've been beating a dead horse on, it seems like, but we're not going to give up on that issue either. I look forward to some great testimony this afternoon and just appreciate everybody being involved and staying involved. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you, Chairman Harkins. And appreciate your comments. I'm also going to give an opportunity here before we start with our panel. We've been joined by another member. If you want to introduce yourself, Representative Burns.
Representative Frank Burns, Cambria County.
Thank you. Okay, we do have a panel of essential workers that we're going to hear from. I'm going to ask members if we could hold all of our questions until the end of the panel. And if the panelists are able to stay till the end, then we'll open it up for questions from members, both here in the room and remotely. So we're going to start with Steve Cantonese. He is the president of SEIU Local 668. Steve, if you want to get us started. Just make sure you unmute your microphone.
I was asking if I was following the right procedure and you couldn't hear me, so thank you. And how much time should we each have on our remarks, or just kind of try to keep it short?
Yeah, if we could keep it, about 5 or so minutes, that would be helpful.
Okay, hopefully it shouldn't take that long, but thank you very much for this opportunity. My name is Steve Catneys. I'm the president of SEIU Local 668. We were founded as the Pennsylvania Social Services Union. We're one of the SEIU locals in Pennsylvania. Together, we represent tens of thousands of workers. Our local in specific tends to represent workers in public services. Like you'll hear from a unemployment compensation worker today, represent workers in welfare, child welfare, aging, corrections, things like that as well, counselors, social workers. I really appreciate you all taking the time to talk about this work for essential workers, the issues facing them under COVID-19, because for many essential workers, as I'm sure you'll hear today, the paradigm under which they've operated has shifted dramatically within the last several months. It goes without saying that the paradigm for most workers has shifted, but just to peek behind the curtain for essential workers, upon the impact upon the United States, really in March, understanding that the coronavirus is going to be something that lasted for a long time, thousands of workers who weren't already considered essential workers were suddenly classified into essential type positions. Beyond the workers that are already on a day-to-day basis, like your nurses and your doctors, thousands of other positions suddenly also became essential as well. When all these burdens shifted to not only the traditional essential workforce, but the quote-unquote non-traditional essential workforce, we found that something, I guess, that our union has been preaching for a long time was really true, that the rules are written in a way that it's broken and works against working people. We've seen millions of workers who are called quote-unquote essential over the last several months risking their lives. Millions of workers making under $15 an hour, people sent to deal with our most vulnerable populations without protective equipment, minimal paid sick time, workers risking their lives in some cases without health insurance, without a guarantee of economic security, and often without the ability to even join together in a union to be able to bargain for basic conditions like this. What I suspect you'll hear from many of the folks testifying today is we all want these same basic things: safety on the job, security for our families, and a fair and decent chance to live our lives, better futures for our children, and better futures for children that might not even be our own. I'm struck by an anecdote I heard last week from one of our workers, a child welfare worker in the middle of the state. And in this case, you know, sent with minimal PPE out to a endangered child situation, the child had to be removed from their home and taken to an NCU, an NICU, because the child needed severe medical care. So the worker took this child into this situation, found out the next day that there was a coronavirus outbreak in the hospital where the NICU was. That worker made $13 an hour. And there are workers that are making less than that. That worker who took that child out of that at-risk situation to try to get them help into an additional risky situation needed a college degree for that job to make $13 an hour. Workers in that situation, this is not an abnormal thing I'm bringing up, right? Workers in situations such as that are being asked to risk their lives, take on unprecedented burdens. And to this point, as was being indicated earlier, we haven't seen the level of help I think we need from the federal government to really help out with them. The CARES Act was helpful in some ways, but it didn't go as far enough as our state and our county governments are going to be needing. I appreciate Representative Harkin's comments earlier because something has come up regularly, and I'd be remiss without stating at the start of this hearing, is most of the public does not realize that public sector workers do not have OSHA protections, the very basic foundation of occupational safety standards. In Pennsylvania, a bill has been released that Representative Harkins lifted every single year that would provide OSHA protections to workers. When a lot of our public workforce that was essential was attempting to get basic protections at the start of this coronavirus, they were asking for things like OSHA-level protection without an actual legal right to it, right? While they were asking for basic legal protections, you know, nurses were going into facilities without basic PPE. The system that was in place, again, was never created in a way that was truly going to be responsive to needs of workers in such a time of crisis. This is a situation where we cannot return to normal. The so-called normal that we had prior to the coronavirus doesn't work for service workers who are deemed essential, and it never has. normal work does not work for communities who've been impacted by the coronavirus, where people have had to risk their lives for our families just to earn a paycheck. You know, normal does not work for workers of any race who've been exploited by corporations like McDonald's. At this moment, it is a moral imperative that our state government, our Commonwealth government, lift itself up, do what it can to be a voice and to take bold risks to challenge the status quo in a way that working people are going to know that the government has its back. If they're going out and risking their lives, it's a moral imperative that the government shows that it's supporting them with the utmost risks it can take. So if I'm gonna just give any general ask before I shift this over to the workers that are putting on these burdens in fields like healthcare, property service, and public service, it is that through this policy hearing, think of ways that some of these basic crises that are happening on a day-by-day basis, some that might may feel like, I know that I'm going to expect to feel like I'm going to hear some things that I say, why is that even there in the first place? Doesn't that seem like a simple fix? There should be things we can hear on this call that seem like simple, common sense solutions. Sometimes those common sense solutions, like a guarantee to healthcare or simple hazard pay for taking on risks that most of these workers are not getting, should be a common sense thing we should work towards. And ways in which we can do this collaboratively, pushing the federal government or using what resources the Commonwealth has to achieve this purpose, I just urge this committee to do what it can, take risks, challenge the status quo. We're in a new paradigm, we're in a new era. And I just really appreciate you all taking the time to listen to workers today and hopefully figure out ways we can move forward as a result of this hearing. I'm happy to have answer any questions you may all have, especially in regards to the law or our organizational positions on matters. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve. We appreciate your testimony. Next up, we're going to have Sean Domenico, unemployment compensation worker and SEIU Local 668 member from Allegheny County. Sean, are you available? Just want to unmute your
microphone.
Have
I successfully unmuted myself? Hello?
Yeah, we can hear you. Now you just need to click your video on also.
By phone.
Oh, you're by phone. Okay. We can hear you.
Thank you. And I do apologize that I was unable to make the software work for the video, but I appreciate the opportunity to speak with you verbally. So, first of all, thank you very much for giving us all a chance to tell some of the stories and give you some perspective today. As you already know, yes, I am an unemployment worker. I work in the Pittsburgh area in Allegheny County. And specifically, I'm a claims examiner for unemployment compensation. So my current overarching duty is to make the determinations on people's eligibility for their benefits. And one of the key things that's important about that is to remember that we still, one of the reasons that we are so busy, as I'm sure each of you is well aware, whether you're veterans of the legislature or not, I'm sure you've been contacted quite a bit by constituents who need assistance and are having trouble getting a hold of us. One of the reasons we are so busy is because the unemployment system does not, administer benefits based strictly on need. We have to review eligibility and go through the various provisions of the law. So during the time that we've gone through this transition, as President Katniss did mention, many of us transitioned, like so many other workers in the rest of the economy, we transitioned from being non-essential employees to being essential employees. And those of us in unemployment knew that that was something that was coming. We recognized what role we were going to play. And so so far, we've had a very valuable and productive relationship with the Secretary of Labor and Industry and our directors in unemployment service centers and policy. It's the work that we've been able to do together that has made some of the transitions for our workers reasonable, and we appreciate that. But in doing our work, We've tried very hard to deal with the unprecedented number of claims, but that work has necessitated hiring new people. And I think if I were to ask for one thing more than anything, it is just to give us the financial resources that we need to make sure that we can continue to hire staff. It may seem unnecessary as we try to, slowly reconfigure and reopen our economy, but there is a backlog of work that needs to be gone through. And at this stage, we are still hiring people and the agency is doing the best it can, but what it does necessitate is taking individuals like me and putting them into new positions of leadership. Plenty of people with whom I have worked who have only done examiner work for a year or two or three are now working as supervisors because it's necessary. And that means that we're going to be taking people who normally just would ask, talk to people and ask them questions. We're going to be training them and teaching them how to do the work that I do. And that is not a simple task. The unemployment law is complex, and we don't have clearance from the federal government to make broad, sweeping changes to it. The agency has done what it can to make the process a little bit simpler, like removing the waiting week and also removing the guidelines on searching for work, which both of which made sense. But there are various other parts of the law that need to be dealt with. So ultimately, we have to train. We're doing so much training in order to make sure that people, that citizens and employers both, are treated fairly. And that's the thing to remember for those of us working in unemployment is we are arbitrating between the employers and the workers right now. I'm sure all of you have plenty of context for that as you deal with your various areas of trying to set what is right and just and safe both for workers and for just ordinary citizens. The other thing is. As we go through this process, we've become well aware, and I do thank Representative Harkins for his repeated submissions of the public sector OSHA law. But we do need to focus on that. But workers do still need PPE, personal protective equipment, and more than anything, we need to find a way to get as much testing as possible, so that invariably, if someone does get ill, or does feel like they need a test, that they can get access to it, not just for us, but for everyone, so that we can continue to be able to work from home or work in the environments that we've got. The last thing I'd say is I've talked to many workers who know that they need some assistance of some kind, with finding ways to care for their children, or maybe some extra sick time. We started conversations about that, but those are the types of things that are necessary in a different world like this, where suddenly you're not working in an office environment and you can't, parents simply can't drop their children off with someone like they were doing so. Now they're trying to either manage that at home, or they're suddenly finding that the childcare that they used to use can't take the children. And so finding ways to maybe, look around the public sector workers and the other workers and realize how can we encourage businesses to either expand their childcare businesses or help others stand up so that we can have more access. If you can't get as many children into a location or it's not feasible, we need to find ways to have more. Those would be my suggestions on things that we could see. I would be more than happy to answer any questions you have about your concerns with unemployment claims or PUA or other things whenever you have a chance. And I thank you again for your time.
Thank you, Sean. We appreciate your testimony. Maybe we could have your hotline number and we'll call you directly on our unemployment claims. We appreciate your work, though. Next up, if she's available, we have Dahlia Cruz. She is the lab and clinic cleaner and CASA member in York County. So, Dahlia, if you want to unmute your microphone and put your video on, we'd be pleased to have your testimony. Okay, it looks like you're trying, so we just need you to unmute the microphone if you want to click that icon, and we can see you now and hear you now. Thank you. You might want to back up just a little bit, or bring your computer up a little bit. Yeah.
Like that.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Hi, my name is Dalia Cruz, and I am from Mexico.
I'm sorry, Adalia. Yeah. We just need you to adjust because we're catching.
Bring a little higher.
Yeah.
All we see is your nose and mouth.
Yeah. All we see is your nose and mouth. So you want it to go the other direction? Nope. The other way.
Otherwise.
Yeah. Down a little bit.
There you go.
Perfect.
Perfect.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. So, hi, my name is Dalia Cruz. I am from Mexico. I arrived to your Pennsylvania in 2002. I am a DACA recipient and a mother of two amazing children. I am also a proud member of CASA. CASA is one of the most biggest Latinos and member-led organization in Pennsylvania. And like I say, I have been working in the lab for over a year where we receive blood samples, tests, and them. I work on all night, so I take care of my two children during the day. And since I work only 4 hours, I don't have access to full health coverage. And both my undocumented husband and myself are essential workers. We are both thankful to this land and the opportunity that we have been given in working and raising our children here. But it is hard to keep working knowing that our lives are not being valued or respected. This is not just a public health crisis. It is as well an economic crisis that is hitting brown and black people the most. We need to protect our public health, and we need to protect it now, regardless of immigration status. Every day, my husband and I have to decide to put not just our life at risk, but also our children's. Every day, we have to decide between our lives or food on our table. Every day, we have to decide if all this effort is worth it, when the message that we kept hearing from our representative is that we don't belong here. To conclude, I will say that I am hopeful. I am hopeful that despite the physical, economic, and emotional impact of this pandemic, we DACA recipients, undocumented TPS holders, and all immigrants, we are resilient and we are proving every day that home is here, and that we matter to this country as much as this country matters to us. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dalia, for your testimony and your hard work as well. Next, you're welcome. Next up, we have Eve Carlton. Dalia, if you want to, there you go. Eve, if you want to unmute yourself and put your camera on, Eve is with a bicycle security officer and SEIU 32BJ member from Philadelphia County. So thanks for joining us, Eve, and we look forward to your comments and your testimony.
Hi, how are you? Are you able to see me okay?
Yeah, we can see you and hear you. Thank you.
Okay. Good afternoon to all the elected officials and fellow panelists. I am Eve Carlton. I am a bike security officer in Philadelphia. I am here to advocate for essential workers, specifically security officers like myself, cleaners, grocery store workers, and the others that are out there. The workers that whom we've kept the country running during this pandemic. All essential workers need hazard pay, PPE, and extended unemployment benefits. I worked in security for 2 years, but never did I feel I was needed until now. I, alongside with my fellow coworkers, have worked consistently throughout this entire triple pandemic of COVID-19, economic and racial injustices, and it's been a rough 4 months. COVID-19 has exposed injustices that people of color have known about for their entire lives. Many of us work without paid sick days, which should not even be questioned during these times. People are working two and three essential jobs, trying to make ends meet. And if they get sick with COVID, they end up missing pay because they don't have sick days. Then it takes time for them to catch up financially, but they never do. This is a vicious cycle. We all know this disease impacts people of color more than any other race. The majority of the essential workers are people of color. We just can't catch a break. We need our elected leaders to help us with those things that we need, PPE, hazard pay, and extended unemployment benefits. While many people were able to follow the governor's order to shelter in place, we worked. Many of my colleagues and union brothers and sisters went without PPE and continued to work. That's unfathomable. PPE helps protect the spread of the disease. Like paid sick days, PPE should be given, especially in a pandemic. Because we showed up day in and day out, we often need work extended hours with the same pay. The virus didn't stop our bills from coming. Many people worked around the clock and didn't get any sign of the hazard pay. Hazard pay is the least thing that we can get for all the work that we do. This triple pandemic has unfortunately seen many hardworking men and women lose their jobs. They are essential workers that have been laid off without the unemployment protections. Many workers won't even be able to make it. They might be laid off. Their needs to continue. There still needs to be able to provide for their families and keep the roof over their head. To conclude, in this time of need, constituents need to show compassion. While cheering nightly for workers is a nice gesture, it's not enough. Essential workers didn't call these ills, and right now we're working through tough times. We need PPE, hazard pay, and unemployment protections. I thank you for your time.
Thank you, Eve.
You're welcome.
Next, we are going to move to Kelly Trent. Kelly is an insurance claims correspondence agent and PA Joint Board Workers United member from Perry County. Hi, Kelly.
Hi, guys.
Thank you for joining us. We can see and hear you, so we're happy to have your testimony.
Great. My name is Kelly. I am the mother of two. I am the wife of a person that is immunocompromised. I'm a shop steward. I'm a leader in my shop, and I'm an essential worker. I work at a dental insurance company right across the river in Mechanicsburg. I'm the person that answers the phone when you call about your claims and benefits or when your dentist calls about your claims and benefits. I've been lucky because I've been able to work from home, stay safe, and haven't lost my job. A large number of my union members paid out of pocket to purchase the items that they needed to effectively work from home when our building closed with no notice or they were left unable to work. They had to purchase computers and office equipment, and for working families with children now at home, this was a significant hardship. As a leader in the union, I'm worried about my union members because we're being forced back to work in our office building. There have been two phases called back so far. In that time, we've had four people pass the health check and be granted access to the building, but be sick enough that management staff sent them home, told them that they need to get tested, and they tested positive for COVID. We have a total of 9 people under quarantine, not including the 4 positive cases. In those two phases, there have only been 24 people brought back to work. For those of you like me that aren't great at math, that's 13 people. Our job has the ability to telework and is refusing to let us continue to do so, regardless of the governor's mandate. They're not enforcing the mask policy. They're not enforcing social distancing. The company is waiting until Fridays to let us know if anyone else has tested positive so they don't have to shut down the building for a day to clean. The company is not notifying my union members in a timely manner if they've come in contact with someone that tested positive. The company is forcing those people that have come in contact with someone that has tested positive to report to work unless they are actively showing symptoms. Our site is comprised mostly of female staff, most of which travel across the river from Harrisburg because our job has good pay and good benefits thanks to the union contract. We are the working mothers of the Commonwealth. Daycares are at limited capacity. We're facing serious decisions about homeschooling our children while working full-time because sending them back to school isn't safe. We're not able to take care of our children and work full-time and feel safe at work. There have been a number of complaints filed with the Department of Health in regards to everything that I've spoken about. The Department of Health refers us to the governor's office to try to get help. The governor's office referred us to the state police to try to get help. The state police referred us to the local police to try to get help because the company is violating the governor's mandate. The local police said they can't help us. Essential workers need help. We need PPE. We need hazard pay. We need paid sick leave, and we need someone to enforce the policy or the policies that the governor has set forth. We need you to bring essential workers to the table when you're making these decisions. Thank you.
Thank you, Kelly. Appreciate your testimony. Next up, we have Tom Smith. Tom is a consumer-directed health care worker and United Home Care Workers of PA member, and he is from Montgomery County. So, Tom, if you want to unmute your microphone, turn your video on, and we'll take your testimony now.
Can you hear me?
Yes. Very good.
All right. Hello, and thank you for inviting me to speak today. My name is Tom Smith, and I'm a home care worker in Montgomery County for Pennsylvania's participant or consumer-directed healthcare system. We are hired to come into the homes of our clients and provide direct care support to individuals with disabilities and who need assistance with their activities of daily living. Direct care workers are the keystone of Pennsylvania's long-term services and support system, taking care of us and our loved ones that are most vulnerable. In our profession, social distancing is impossible between us and the people we care for. Our work requires close personal contact with our clients, and during a pandemic, this puts both of us in harm's way. As the people who serve this vital role, we deserve basic protections like paid sick time, PPE, and appropriate training to keep ourselves and our consumers safe. Most caregivers, including all of the participant-directed caregivers, have absolutely no paid time off. The fact that caregivers have to routinely choose between a paycheck and going to work sick is a huge problem. But during a global health crisis, it's an absolute catastrophe. Many caregivers are the first and last line of defense for their consumers, and their ability to take shifts off is already limited without the additional financial threats of having to sacrifice part of their paycheck. A stressed home care system spells disaster for both caregivers and our consumers. When I have been sick in the past, I have had no choice but to make extreme sacrifices. Now with the coronavirus pandemic, home care workers face an impossible decision. We already work for low wages, and we each face a personal financial emergency if we have to make the unappealing decision to self-quarantine and lose multiple days or weeks of pay. Our consumers are dependent on us for the tasks of daily living. When they're without support, they face hospitalization or institutionalization, which only increases the likelihood that they'd be exposed to the coronavirus. Many of those people cannot be quarantined alone and would require an extra degree of personal care, care that home care workers would normally provide in a home setting, now provided in an institutional setting. During this public health emergency, this would cost resources from hospitals and long-term care facilities that they simply cannot afford. It's critical that we pass House Bill 2391 so that essential workers can have essential benefit of paid sick leave. I also wanted to talk about PPE and training. As a consumer-directed caregiver, PPE is completely unavailable to me. As opposed to agencies, hospitals, and care facilities that can purchase PPE as an institution, I must purchase all of my PPE myself with my already stretched wages from this job. This includes all masks, gloves, and cleaning supplies. Many consumers who use the consumer-directed model are forced to make the same decision, either purchase it for your caregiver or go entirely without. Frontline caregivers in a hospital or institutional setting have protocols and guidelines, but many home caregivers are left to just figure it out. Putting that responsibility on us requires us to have training that we just don't have. Especially during COVID-19, we need training on cleaning processes, how to use PPE most effectively to promote patient and caregiver safety, and how we can best prevent the virus from circulating if one of us or our clients catches it. Consumer-directed home care workers don't have access to any special trainings from the state, and we need such a statewide training program so that home care workers have the educational tools we need to provide quality care in the midst of this pandemic. Home care workers are an absolutely crucial part of our state's healthcare and long-term support system. We provide support to our fellow citizens who, without that support, would be forced to make many difficult and stressful decisions about their dignity, safety, and independence. Please support us so that we aren't forced to make those same difficult decisions, not only for our consumers, but for ourselves. If we're essential workers, we need to know that the state has our back. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Next up, lastly, we have Barbara Coleman. Barbara is a nursing home worker and SEIU healthcare PA member, and she's from Lackawanna County. And so, Barbara, you want to unmute your microphone, turn your video on, and once you do that, you can start with your testimony.
Good afternoon. Can everybody hear me? Can you see me?
Yes, we can. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that. Hi, my name is Barbara Coleman, and I'm a CNA in the Northeast Flood, as you said, Lackawanna County. I work in a nursing home. One on a daily basis as we're frontline essential workers, and we work with residents, and we don't have the adequate staff, and we don't have access to PPE. But when you're a nursing home worker, you don't think about, you know, not having the equipment and stop working. You continue to work because it comes down to a choice that either you choose, you know, your family at home or the nursing home residents, which are your family also. So you have to continue on and choose both families, and you just pray and hope that you do not bring it home to your family members. Because when you don't have access to this and you don't have nothing in nursing, you will not stop. You will continue to do your job and provide the care, because a lot of these residents, they don't know nothing about this. The last thing they heard was like the swine flu. So they don't know nothing about COVID-19. And it's not, we can't isolate them because of something that's not correct outside. So we choose them as family, and we continue on a daily basis to work with these people and give them everything they need, even though we don't have the equipment to do it, and we put our own family at risk. So that's one thing that we have to, we ask you guys for the PPD and the hazard pay for them on a daily basis, because these residents are our family members on a daily basis. So we make sure when we go to work, we purchase on our own. Sometimes we have to do that to make sure to be safe. We purchase on our own supplies, because the administrator doesn't have it. And even for myself, when I was a family member of mine tested positive, and I called my administrator for me to just stay out. And he was like, oh, I need you to come in. And I said, no, I will not come in. I had to get my union involved, because I said, I won't do that. I'm not going to put other people's lives at risk because you need a body to work a shift. I said, so I'm going to self-quarantine like the governor said to do correctly, and make sure I don't put nobody else at risk, and I'm not going to be killing members off because of this virus. And that's the unfortunate part of healthcare, is that we don't have the adequate, nothing of PPE, and that's what we fight for on a daily basis, and that we have to still provide care. We cannot shut down healthcare just because we don't have stuff. When you in the nursing field, you wear your heart. So you continue on no matter when you don't have stuff, you keep going and you keep pushing. And that's what makes us strong on a daily basis. That's what makes us who we are and what we do when it comes to the healthcare profession. So we're currently, you know, in sector, we don't have it. And that's what we're asking, you know, for you guys to supply us with people, you know, to give us hazard, to make sure that they have the adequate nursing hours for us to do our job. We're not asking for much, but it seems like it's a lot. It's not much for us to help out, just for us to continue to do what we do on a daily basis. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you, Barbara. And now we're going to open it up to questions from both from members in the room and those participating remotely. If you are joining us remotely, please use the chat function or raise your hand so that we know you have a question. And we're going to start off with Chairman Bill Courts.
Thank you, Chairman Longetti, and thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for your testimony today. Very compelling and very critical testimony. Kelly, Trent, are you still on the line?
I am.
Kelly, I believe I heard you say that you reached out to the governor's office. He passed the buck down to the Department of Health, to the state police, to the local police. Is that correct?
That is correct. So we actually started with the Department of Health. The Department of Health got so many complaints from our office, they referred us to the governor's office. One of my union members spoke with someone in the governor's office, and they said that we needed to contact the state police. The state police said they could not enforce the mandate to call the local police, and the local police were like, we don't know what you're talking about. We can't do anything about that.
So the bottom line is no one's done anything, correct?
Correct.
You know, it's very interesting that the governor sends in the state police, the LCE agents. They've been going into bars and restaurants like stormtroopers on my way. It's amazing that he's attacking businesses on that end, but he won't reach out when he's been given this complaint to even help you. I would highly recommend that you put this in a letter to him and explain your disappointment how this is, the can's been kicked down the road. The bottom line is that you and your co-workers are now in danger, and demand action from the governor, because it ultimately the buck stops there. It's on his plate, and he needs to take action and make it happen by getting the state police in there. So I'd highly recommend you put it in a letter to him directly and explain what you've done, that you've followed the protocols and that nothing's being done, and you and your co-workers feel that you're at risk. So I would highly recommend you do that.
Do you have any suggestions about getting the letter to the top of what I'm sure is a very large pile of other letters for him?
I'm sorry, what's that?
I said, do you have any suggestions about how to get that letter to the top of the pile? Because I'm sure he has a large pile of letters.
Send it to the committee, Chairman Sterla, and we'll take it right to the top, and we'll demand action from the governor. He should be addressing this kind of stuff. He's doing it on other levels in different businesses. But for some reason, he's just kicked you guys to the side, and it's wrong.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, thank you, Chairman Quartz. Sure. Next, we have Representative Isaacson.
Kelly, can you come back on?
Yes, ma'am.
Just following up on Representative Quartz's questioning, have you gone to the Attorney General with regard to your corporation's noncompliance?
No, we haven't. Our corporation, we're an enterprise. We're actually based in three different states, and they're saying that we're essential. And, you know, to dumb it really, really down, we're a contact center. There's no reason for us to be in an office together when we have the ability to telework. We have not taken it to the Attorney General. Is that a suggestion that maybe we should try taking?
Yes, I would definitely contact the Attorney General's office with regard to your employer's interpretation of whether you're an essential worker, the work environment that they're forcing you to work in under an emergency order. I think that perhaps you might be able to find some assistance there.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay, next up, we're going to go to a question from Representative Hohenstein, who is participating remotely. If you could put your microphone, take it off of mute, and we'll take your question.
Yep. This is a question, I think, for Steve mostly, and maybe also for Tom, and that is, with PPEs, what has the union spent itself or out of its own resources for PPEs for members? And what are the mechanisms for you guys to even begin to seek reimbursement for the PPE outlays that you've had to undertake for yourselves and for your membership, if you're even able to?
So Tom, unless you want to talk on this first, by all means.
I don't have a lot of information on.
Yeah, I mean, I would say it's a double-edged thing. And I'll give a good example of some of the hazards on this. If you go back into early on in the pandemic, One of our sister healthcare locals out in California, a very large local, went to extreme ends to figure out ways to get PPE. They were able to get a contract for like $3 million or something, N95 masks. And if you Google it, you'll find it popped up on CNN that actually they were getting defrauded. It was a big scam. So I know at least for us as a local now, some of the healthcare locals may speak to this as well. I know at least for us, my local, which was a lot of the public sector workers, a lot of the state employees, things like that. It's hit and miss depending on where you're at. We get reports, especially at some of the counties where the PPE is still lacking, where people who are going into in-home services have minimal. For us, the initial policies were that people weren't supposed to wear masks. After time, most of our members at least have cloth masks. Now, most of these are, we typically go into this that you want to have an employer-provided thing, because if you ask probably any of the union workers on this hearing, most of your contracts are going to say it's incumbent on your employer to provide a safe environment. But knowing that, and this goes a little bit back into some of the earlier questions, but our systems are completely breaking here. We've dipped into buying some PPE for our members in some limited circumstances and putting it out as we can, but that's not typically something we've looked at as a reimbursable thing. It's how do we try to judiciously use money where the employers have failed, but also try not to put out an example out there that where the employers can fail, the unions constantly have to spend this money to provide basic protection that you should get for going onto a job that you're being forced to go onto or to lose it, right? So we haven't been so much looking at a situation where we're going to get a reimbursement from the feds or the state or anything like that, and more as how can we target policies where we can get some PPE out there to help our members in the toughest circumstances, but even that PPE doesn't tend to be things like N95 masks.
What's the best legislative fix, either at the state or the legislative or the federal level? What are the things that you would want to see come out of us? Because I mean, I know we've got a couple of different bills for stockpiling and for provision of PPEs, but what's the most obvious or what you think the easiest legislative fix would be?
Well, before I speak to it, I mean, Tom, you were called on as well. Is that what do you feel like you should have at work?
So I'll just add that as a participant-directed caregiver, we actually have no agency. The employer is technically considered the consumer who hires us. We get paid through the Office of Long-Term Living. But as it stands right now, there isn't actually an agency that we can go to. So, I know that every other participant-directed caregiver I speak to has just bought their stuff online or in stores. I've been sent a couple surgical masks from the union that they sent out to people. I don't know anything about them getting reimbursed from that, but it's not adequate. I would say that whatever ends up happening, as long as the participant-directed caregivers are somehow included in that it doesn't just go to agencies and hospitals, that would be just my priority.
And just to follow up with Tom, I mean, like, if I have my wish, at the federal level, they're actually printing significant sums of money and providing an extensive stimulus to the Commonwealth. And for, to speak to the work that folks like Sean are doing on employment compensation, you find a program like pandemic unemployment, which really should be extended, but was sent to these states with so many different restrictions and regulations on exactly how it has to be done. And it's become this especially onerous burden to do the work itself because the feds put so many restrictions on it. But so many of these small business loans, quote unquote ones that have gone to large companies, it shouldn't seem to be that hard that, if people are being given this money for certain expenses to maintain operations, I would hope there would be some indication that there would be an emphasis on ensuring you're providing the adequate type of PPE that meets CDC and OSHA standards for a safe workforce, right? Or as Eve is mentioning in the chat, if you can get employers to pay some fines for not providing adequate equipment. I'm about to go off further on this thing, but I would just say that it's hard to find good enforcement mechanisms, especially in this moment when everything is stretched.
Okay, thank you both. Just a couple questions. You might as well stay on, Steve.
no worries.
If you could just talk a little bit more, and I know Chairman Harkins talked about it as well, but just so that our audience understands the difference between the public sector worker versus the private sector worker and OSHA standards and the lack of safety standards in public sector workforce.
Sure. And if you don't mind, I might just touch a little bit on the situation Kelly's facing as well and kind of loop all these things together as best I can, because I think it kind of gets to an important point. So it's interesting because we've done a few press conferences and interviews talking about worker safety. And what always seems to be surprising to people is that workers in the public sector don't inherently have OSHA. So OSHA is general public or safety work rules for workers. That is a national law and it applies in the private sector. But part of the issue, I guess, for a public sector worker with OSHA, and by the public sector, you know, again, we're talking about anybody who works for the Commonwealth, who works for a county, work jobs that are for the public, right? Unless your state adopts provisions to opt in to OSHA, then the public workforce in that state does not have OSHA protection. And Pennsylvania is part of a, I think inglorious might be the right word, list of states or a commonwealth in our case that has no OSHA protection for public employees. So in many cases, if you're a worker and you find that something, it's a basic OSHA standard, just like basic signage about what your safety rights are, things like that. If you find out that these very basic provisions that are kind of uniform across the private sector world aren't being followed, you can normally file a complaint to OSHA to come investigate it. In the public sector, that's just not a right unless your state's opt in. In Pennsylvania, despite us trying for years and years and years, there's just never been the legislative courage to actually give the public workforce that right. I can't speak to why people would do it. We look at it as a moral issue as to this seems like a basic fair protection for people. But even in this moment, like talking about Kelly's problem where the employer seems to be violating very basic OSHA protections as well, what we started to see in the private sector is as coronavirus is really ramped up is OSHA enforcement itself isn't even going that well. And it does tend to be because year by year, these enforcement mechanisms for these very basic labor law protections that if you look at America and Pennsylvania internationally, we're not at the top of the list. We're not even probably midway through the class, right? I don't think we make honor roll in terms of how our labor laws are written. Every year, the basic labor laws have been chipped away. We had the Janus decision at the Supreme Court a few years back. The National Labor Relations Board keeps chipping away at things. Every year there's budget cuts. These budget cuts tend to chip away at all the different little ways that workers rely on to have these basic, the basic social contract they have to work safely. So when we talk about rewriting the rules, like this is a really big thing. Like Pennsylvania needs OSHA protection for public sector workers, right? But then all workers need effective mechanisms to make sure they're enforced. And it takes collaboration from the governor's office, the General Assembly, local officials, and it really takes the courage to say this is something worth investing in worker safety. And at a time like now, I think is when the safety of essential workers who don't really have much of a choice right now of where and how to work should be at the forefront. So I know I went a little bit in a broader direction there, but I thought it was a really important point worth making on OSHA.
I appreciate that overview. That's very helpful.
Thank you.
And I don't know if Chairman Harkins is still available, but if he is, you know, I know it's his legislation. And one of the stories behind it, because he had a hearing up in Erie where we were at a couple years ago, involved a bus driver that worked in the public sector. And I don't know, Chairman, are you still available if you are?
Yeah. I am, yes, Mark.
Yeah, if you could maybe talk about that, because I think it really drives the point home of you know, what happens when you don't have those kind of protections in place.
Sure, it's a very involved issue, and Jake Schwab was a mechanic at EMTA, Erie Metropolitan Transit Authority. He was using a jack to lift a bus up that needed repairs that was given to him by a superior supervisor, and it was the wrong jack. It was the wrong jack for the weight that he was lifting. And it came crashing down on him along with the bus, and it crushed him. He survived for a few days after, but he was not to come back. The family was never given any finality as far as the investigative process, because with it not being a public, OSHA standards as far as even that goes, the family wasn't given anything as far as details about his death. The insurance company wasn't legally obliged to give that information out. And then at the same time, the wife was given some stipend, but she had to sign a declaration saying that if she were to remarry, she would give that up. There was all kinds of side things like that. So not only the abuse of the employee at the time and not being given the essential tools that they need safety-wise, the things for the survivors, and even if a person wasn't killed in the line of duty, if they were seriously injured to the point of not being able to come back and do that job again, you have to weigh in all those kinds of concerns. And like I said, I enjoyed that at UPS, working there for 25 years as a delivery driver. Every day you had safety pounded into you. It worked for the private sector. They could afford it. There's no reason that we can't in the public sector.
Well, thank you for sharing that story. I remember very vividly your hearing, and really, as you indicated, the lack of closure that the family had, because there really wasn't the type of investigation that needed to happen, and there wasn't the sharing of the results of that to get a better understanding of what went wrong that led to the death of Mr. Schwab. So that certainly is a gap in our current law, and we appreciate your trying to move that bill forward and authoring that bill.
We won't give up on it. Even when I go on a construction site, or if I go in something where the water authority locally is working, everybody clams up, but they slip me notes or they ask for my personal email address, and I hear the horror stories that continue, but without anything to give them, it's hard to promise something that you can't deliver on.
Yes,
Mr.
Absolutely.
Chairman, if I could add a comment.
Sure, Chairman Quartz.
You may. And the shame of it is, and thank you, Chairman Harkins, for pushing that bill forward. The shame of it is, history's going to repeat itself, and we're going to have other Jake Schwabs across this Commonwealth unless that gets passed, so you can put things in place to prevent that. And shame on us for not getting this done and getting this into law. And I hope that we'll have success shortly down here, Mr. Chairman. I hope we can get this into law.
Very good.
Thank you, Chairman Quartz. I appreciate the support.
And one other question for Kelly, if she's still available. One of the things that Kelly mentioned in her testimony was that at least initially there was some remote working, and mm-hmm. that people in some cases were required to purchase or find their own equipment like computers or connectivity or what have you. Mm-hmm. And I can't imagine what the expense of that could be for some folks. But I wanted to know, what if I were the employee and I said, look, I don't have that kind of equipment and I can't afford it. Mm-hmm. What happens? Do I lose my job? How did that all play out?
That's a really good question. So our contract has language in regards to layoffs. And if you were told that you needed to purchase this equipment to work from home and you couldn't, and we actually had a number of members that couldn't, we were able to use something that the company came up with called ETO, which means emergency time off. That wound up being about 6 weeks of paid time. When that ran out, you could use up all of your accrued time. When that ran out, you had to file for unemployment. The company refused to put people on a layoff status because our contract language is really good. It says you'd have to pay people 2 weeks for every year that they've been there. And unfortunately, you know, as a working family, not only, let me just back up a second before I go any further. Not only did you have to purchase equipment, you had to have certain equipment. So, for instance, Chromebooks, which some of you guys may know, some of you may not, are a little cheaper. They didn't work with the system that they needed. MacBooks, which some people had, and from my understanding, they're very expensive. I can't afford one of those, didn't work with it. So you weren't able to use what you already had in some cases. So in that case, you were to be put on unemployment. And if you weren't able to work from home, you were one of the people that got called back first, which may sound like, oh, great, you know, the company brought these people that couldn't work from home, couldn't afford these things, back into work first. But you have to kind of think about it this way. Now, at this point, you've already used all of the possible paid time off that you can. You are called back into the building, and COVID cases are popping up left and right. So now you are going to be in a position where you will not be paid and will be losing your job.
Wow. So people are actually exhausting the earned time off that they had and had accrued and certainly wanted to save in a case of a situation where they had to be off work. And mm-hmm. here they are because they couldn't afford this equipment to work remotely, potentially using up all that time.
Right.
Okay. Thank you for that explanation. Okay, are there any other members that have a question or would like to be recognized for a comment? Okay, none remotely. Anybody in the room? Okay. All right, well, I want to thank all of our testifiers. I want to thank you for your time and your effort in putting your testimony together, for staying around for questions. It's been a very informative hearing. I certainly want to thank Chairman Mike Sterla of the House Democratic Policy Committee for scheduling this very important hearing, and of course Chairman Pat Harkins, our ranking Democrat on the House Labor and Industry Committee. So thank you all. We'll conclude the hearing now, and appreciate all your testimony and your information.